One is a practical poster child of early Disney adventure flicks. The other is its animated sci-fi descendant that I am absolutely not going to be unbiased about. Treasure Island and Treasure Planet. They Remade It. And welcome back to another episode of They Remade It. I'm your host, Stuart.
And I'm your host, Jacob.
It's fucking hot. I'll just get into it. My God, it's warm. I don't like it.
Yeah, I mean, I sympathize. It is very hot. It's hot here as well. My house is like 67. Well, usually it's 67. I turn the AC. I always pause the AC for the purposes of recording, but it's chilled.
I mean, if you need to turn it back on, you can.
No, it'll completely ruin my audio, so no.
Yeah, fair enough.
I don't think I will.
Yeah, it's been a bit of a time. Hoping y'all in the Northeast and Northwest are keeping cool out there. There's been a few heat waves hitting at once, it looks like. So, yeah. Power to y'all, and very sorry you're having to deal with that, because let me tell you, I'm not a happy camper.
Yeah, stay chilled. Well, especially, yeah, where you are right now, I'm sure.
Yeah, I mean, it's always hot where I am at this time of year, but this year especially. It's come on really early, so.
Yeah,
it hasn't been great.
Especially humid.
Oh, yeah, I mean, it's never not humid where I am. I essentially live in swampland, so.
Yeah.
It's just going to be humid all the time, so once the heat hits, it's just all the more. So mm-hmm. It's fun watching watching our AC unit just... Because, like, most AC units and everything, obviously, you'll see them, depending on how they're made, you'll sometimes see them kind of spitting out moisture from the air that they have condensed in there. Yeah, once it's humid enough here, there's just a PVC pipe that just leads out of the machine that's just, like, just trickling water constantly. So.
Yikes.
Yeah. It's, like, to the level of, like, the ground around it is constantly sodden, so.
Yeah. Well, best of luck in all your continued endeavors.
Yeah, I will certainly try. But as far as endeavors go, you've been watching/consuming anything? We'll have a shorter list than you this time around, so.
Yeah. Let's go ahead and go into it, I guess. I have a couple things. So first, I mean, as usual, I'm watching a bunch of stuff here and there and everywhere. But I usually, it's so much that I really have to pick what I want to discuss. But, A little question for you. I did this accidentally. It was not planned, but I kind of watched two movies back to back, and they both have the same person in them, so it was an accidental double feature. But I watched both Wes Anderson's The Royal Tenenbaums, and I watched Mike Nichols' The Birdcage for the first time. I watched both of those for the first time.
Oh.
Yes. And can you guess the double feature?
Oh, Well, I know I know the actor, but I've lost his name. Damn. Shit, I don't know. It's like the main patriarchal character in Royal Tenenbaums, and it's the senator character in Birdcage, right?
Yeah, good job. It's Gene Hackman, which completely...
Gene Hackman, that's
it. Yeah, completely by accident, but I sort of did that. And it was a bit of a fun experiment. The Criterion Channel, I should say, which is one of the streaming services that I follow. Is currently having they're always really good about curating the movies that they put on their service, as well as the stuff that they make physical releases for. And every now and again they'll get just the right amount of a certain type of movie that they'll make these sort of curated playlists that you can watch. And since it's a playlist of movies, they're always like 16-17 hours or something. And they have one right now which is just ensemble casts, which are just a bunch of movies back-to-back with really stellar ensemble casts. And these two weren't in order. I kind of cherry-picked them because I'd seen a lot of the others. Either that or, they didn't grab my attention. But It was a fun experiment because both are comedies in very different ways. I enjoyed both to certain degrees. I certainly enjoyed The Birdcage a lot more. I like what Royal Tenenbaums is going for, but it's far from my favorite Anderson. He's done a lot of things that I like better or that resonated more with me.
Yeah. I'm personally not a huge fan of Royal Tenenbaums, but that's for like just some content stuff that I'm just not a big fan of.
Sure. And that's, you know, it's understandable. I mean, to a certain degree, it's one of those things where if you sit everything back to back to back and sort of look at it as a whole, you can probably more easily parse through them or more easily rate them, I guess. If you were to put, like, for example, all of Anderson's stuff back to back to back, you could more easily sort of rate them and order them. But I tend to give his stuff a lot of leeway just because it has his specific feeling, and there are so few people anymore that have a specific feeling, even if it's not one that you particularly care for.
Right, yeah.
But yeah, I enjoyed both for different reasons. I was a big fan of The Birdcage. And that's the thing, is that I had been meaning to watch it for a long time, specifically because of Nathan Lane, but I had never really had a good chance to. I don't think I'd ever just naturally come across it.
I'm honestly kind of shocked about that, because I guess it's not a mutual friend because we're all friends with each other, but our friend Stephanie is a very big fan of this movie, and she showed it to me.
Yes, I'm so. Well aware she's... again, yeah, just I've been meaning to watch for a long time, just never naturally came across it. If, you know, like 7 years ago I had been scrolling through Netflix and it popped up, I would have watched it in an instant, but it wasn't one of those things I was actively going out and trying to obtain a copy of. But at any rate, that was a fun little side thing. I'll have to do that more often. Accidental double features that I don't plan. I'll have to.
Also, I didn't even know that Criterion had their own streaming service. It's actually good to know.
Oh yeah, they have for a while. My favorite thing about the Criterion thing, it's kind of like, I mean, it's not exactly the same thing, but they have a thing that's a little like Pluto, where they just implemented on their streaming service a 24/7 video stream of just Criterion curated movies. And so you can just turn it on and it'll just play them all back to back. And I'm sure there are some people that will use it like TCM, where it's just playing in the background. It's like, oh, what movie's playing?
That person would probably be me. That actually sounds awesome.
Yeah. The only thing is I know it's for a very specific taste, because it's Criterion curated movies. So generally speaking, there's a certain you can expect, you know, I guess a caliber or a reverence that might be held with these, because they're curated. It's not just random stuff pulled off the street, but to that end, it's not split up by genre or time period or anything like that. So
fair enough. I'm fine with it.
But yeah, I like that. Anyways, I also saw two theatrical releases.
Nice.
As I am one to do. But the first one was Bad Boys Ride or Die, which is the new Bad Boys movie with Smith and Lawrence.
I forgot that was a thing, I'm gonna be honest.
Yeah, it was surprisingly pretty decent. It was actually structured like a good comedy. It's fun to see Will Smith in a place where he's not taking himself so seriously. It's been a very long time since he's just done something fun. And
yeah, remember when that was his main thing, was like doing fun and lighthearted stuff?
You know what? I do, but I had forgotten for a bit. Because it's been so long. But yeah, he's fun, and I think him and Lawrence have good chemistry. It's a good thing that Martin Lawrence produced this. I think there's a certain level of oversight that can be probably attributed to the influence that Lawrence had on the comedy specifically, because I think it's pretty well written. There are some flubs in regards to character development. There's a lot of stuff with Smith's character's son pulled in, which, you know, is inherited from the franchise itself, but it's both parts unnecessary development, but also they like speed through it, so it's almost like, why even bother having this in the movie? It doesn't fit anyways, and it doesn't seem like you want to focus on it, so just get rid of that character. This is pointless, you know.
Don't you know, Jake, it's all the rage. You gotta have, you know, reconciled father-son or father-daughter relationships in films and stuff these days.
Yeah, it's just,
Didn't you watch The Last of Us?
The father, actually, I didn't, but I'm familiar with The Last of Us.
Same, I play the game, so.
Yeah, I don't know, I'm done with the reconciliation with fathers specifically, that is the big thing. And it has been for a while, too.
I think a lot of people who grew up with dad issues then got old enough to make movies and shows.
Yeah, it's, well, you can see a clear delineation, because if you watch some movies or, you know, television shows from the 80s and 90s, it's all writers that are like, my stupid wife took my dumb kids and now they don't want to talk to me. And so it's always about how, you know, the father's right and the kids are being assholes. And now it's like wish fulfillment for the children in those positions where it's like, what if daddy said he was proud of me instead? which, you know, yeah. How much, you know, how fun. what a fun premise for a movie. But you know what? Bad Boys Ride or Die, it was still better than whatever the fuck that Bad Boys movie that came out in 2020 was. That was no good. okay. And lastly, the other thing I saw this past Sunday? No, I saw it Saturday. Sunday was Father's Day and I was busy. But Saturday I watched Inside Out 2. And
oh, yeah.
You know what? I have not watched a lot of terrible stuff recently because Inside Out 2 is not terrible. It's
cool.
It's slightly above average. I would put like Disney's Elemental right at that average mark, maybe slightly below average, if not for all the cool animation tricks that are on display in that movie. But Inside Out 2 is like perfectly serviceably fine. It has some funny jokes in there, which, you know, goes to decent writing. It has good vocal performances, even with Mindy Kaling and Bill Hader big dicking the studio and being like, give us more money or we're not coming back, as they are well within their right to do, I think.
Yeah, I'd say so. I mean, it's Disney money, so.
Yeah, well, I think all the voice actors for the movie were offered like $100,000 maybe, except for Amy Poehler, who was given like $5 million. So, I mean, that's something.
Okay, yeah, that's a bit, okay.
it was something like that. But it's not too noticeable with the exception of the fact that Lewis Black gets a lot more screen time in this movie compared to the first one. Which, I mean, I don't know. I like Lewis Black. I think he's funny.
All I can say that I have known about Inside Out 2 is regarding a very brief snippet of a TikTok that Hannah showed me where all the main cast were doing like questions from online. And the word Riz came up, and Lewis Black asked, what's Riz? And Amy Poehler said, it's like short for charisma. And Lewis Black said something to the effect of, I feel like I'm having a stroke.
Yeah,
that's like, yeah, fair, man. I get it.
Yikes. Well, TikTok is bad, but
well,
the one thing I will say, though, it's funny because we were just talking about we're sick of, you know, the daddy, daughter, whatever in movies. Another thing that's overdone, it's slightly warranted in this movie because of the character sets that are here, but I gotta say, stop it with the fucking the panic attacks in movies. I'm done. I get it.
Oh, God, yeah.
I understand. Like
how do we get tropes with panic attacks? Like, come on.
I blame Puss in Boots. Yeah, I'm over it. It doesn't mean anything anymore.
Really enough, I think it actually, for the earliest I can remember it happening is in Iron Man 3. Which is a weird thing to remember.
Yeah, I don't remember.
Oh, God, I just thought about Marvel, unironically.
Well, let's move off of my stuff and go over to your side, and maybe you'll talk about Marvel a little more. I don't know.
I will not, thankfully. As far as movies go, I'm pretty sure I just watched one in this interim. Actually, had some friends over for this one because I kept insisting, like, I have a few friends that just kind of get together and watch movies together on occasion. And I finally, you know, got my social act together and I was like, hey, y'all want to come over and watch a movie? And they're like, sure. We decided to watch the original Mad Max. Cause I had never seen it and most everyone there hadn't seen it. And plus I'd been talking up Fury Road for a while. So I was like, you know what? I should probably see the original.
You alluded to throwing something together in the last episode. You said, I should.
Yeah,
because we were talking about Furiosa. You were like, I should do that. And now you did.
And I did it. Thank God. My socialness actually worked out for once. But yeah, I liked it fine. It's definitely extremely different. I don't know if you've ever seen it. It's extremely different from really even all the rest of the Mad Max films. Just because, and my buddy who has seen all the movies, you know, brought up the fact that it really changes to like the whole the world is dead and society is completely upended kind of thing in the second movie. And the first one, it's kind of more like alluding to the fact that the world is currently in the process of going to shit, but it isn't quite there yet, which is honestly kind of cool to watch because it's still like the semi-realistic kind of thing of, no, this is actually probably what it would really look like for the people having to deal with the world truly coming to a societal end. And like, you know, the few people still trying to keep some amount of order and that sort of thing. And so I thought it was pretty interesting. I even mentioned it when I finished watching it, is that it has the air of a prequel film, of the fact of like, it seems like you were supposed to have watched the other movies before watching this one, because there's so many moments where it's like, oh, that's where he gets this thing, or like, oh, that's why he has this car, or that's why he walks with a limp, or that sort of thing. But it's not. It is just the first movie, and then the ramifications of that movie actually carry over pretty organically into the other ones, which kind of just, I guess, goes to credit George Miller.
Mad Max it's been over a decade since I've seen the Mad Max trilogy, but the first one really, it's a lot slower paced, which is hilarious to consider when you're talking George Miller, but when you look at the other Mad Max films, it feels exceptionally slow, even with all this shit that's going on. And that staple George Miller world building isn't really in place either, at least not to the extent that you can compare it to like something like Beyond Thunderdome, where there's this dome with all these, you know, there's the
I will say, I do like that there's like subtlety behind the world building, though. Like, there's a certain amount of stuff that's meant to kind of go unsaid, it feels like, of just kind of, you know, clearly this, like, you know, it's centering on this like small group of police officers who are basically just kind of keeping the peace out in effectively the bush. And the fact that it's so disjointed feeling, and like you hear like a very brief moment of like when the interceptor as a car gets first brought up, it's like, hey, this is the very last of the V8s. It's like saying like, this is the last V8 engine we can find in general. It's like, that's an interesting statement. Like that kind of, that alone alludes to a lot of what's going on at the time. And it just kind of gives this feeling of the world having gone back to like the Wild West, but somehow even more violent. And so I really do like that, where it doesn't really expect you to have to be handheld through a lot of it. It just kind of goes, this is the world as it is right now. You can only assume some shit has been happening to get to the point that we're at. And I actually like that quite a lot. And it's just, it's so violently different from Fury Road, where Fury Road is effectively a fantasy film at a certain point of just like grand epic tales and everything, especially like 300 levels. And which isn't a bad thing. I still think it's an incredible film. It's still one of my favorite films of all time. But seeing it from a more subdued and, like you said, slower paced perspective, and actually just seeing people's mental states, like, you know, just even watching the Knight Rider at the beginning go frantic to scared to peeling out and everything. It's just, it's wild just kind of seeing how people shift throughout it, and seeing that people actually are going mad in this whole world. So I don't know. I liked it. It's different than I expected. Not a bad thing.
Very good.
Beyond that, haven't really done much in the way of watching things. I will say, I'm all but certain I brought it up on the show before, but I've gotten back into rewatching a bunch of Defunct Land, the YouTube channel either old like theme park history, or like mainly theme parks or theme park attractions that have since gone bust, hence Defunct Land. He just recently released one specifically about, they're called Kid Cities. I don't know if you ever had this thing growing up, or if you did it in school, but there's like these ideas of like these kind of amusement park / educational centers that let kids, you know, like join attractions and like do activities of like simulating adulthood, like, you know, playing as a police officer or a fireman or like bank teller and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
Which I saw that pop up and was immediately flooded with memories, because I did one of those things back in late elementary school, which was, you know, fun and interesting ish but, you know, just decided to watch that, and then I realized, oh yeah, I completely forgot. I absolutely love this guy's stuff, so I've been going back through a bunch of his shit. Kevin Perjurer, which is a hilarious last name, but he's the guy behind it, and it's a veritable documentarian. Like, it's no joke. And the fact that he kind of just keeps one-upping it and everything in one way or another is insane. And apparently he's still working on the final episode of season 3, which has been in the works for like 3 years, so.
Yeah.
But he still releases intermediate content, which is nice.
So. Not that I blame him. That fucking, that ticket, I mean, I'm subscribed to his channel as well. And like that,
I figured, yeah.
That ticket, that fast pass one, was like fucking two and a half hours or something.
Yeah. And it's his most popular video by a factor of 4. It is his most popular, most viewed video.
And I mean, and I get like, it. My favorite's the Garfield Dark Ride one, but I won't judge.
That one's up there for me. Mine is, probably the one about the, I think it's the 64 World's Fair. It's the one about like Robert Moses and Walt Disney, mainly because it's just him taking the time to be like, yeah, Robert Moses was hot garbage. It's like, yeah, he was. That's awesome. But then again, the Garfield one was pretty fucking phenomenal. If you never watched it out there, listeners, it's worth your time. If you want to be really like, if you want just something to put on for a really long time, look up the history of Fastpass with Disney. It's the driest content you can imagine, and that is somehow the most compelling shit you could ever watch. And also watch the Garfield Dark Ride, because it ends with him saying the line, "I have to admit it, a lot of you were really gay in the Garfield Dark Ride." It's like, okay, yeah, that's all you need to know. But yeah, that one, he's a gem of a YouTube guy. It's, I hope he never stops making stuff. Beyond that, only other really thing of note, I have been trying to actually finish playing Legend of Zelda Tears of the Kingdom, because I kept falling off of it, and I'm now dedicating myself to actually finishing it. So I think I only made it halfway through, and I decided just to start over again just because I couldn't remember anything. So I'm obsessing with that a little bit.
Yeah, I'm still debating whether I should just jump into it or not, because I have tried a couple times to do Breath of the Wild. My most recent one was mid last year. And I just, I came to the, you know, final conclusion. It's like, I don't hate Zelda. I like Legend of Zelda. I don't think I like Breath of the Wild.
It is kind of a lot.
Wasn't resonating with me at all.
Yeah. I don't know what it is. Like, there is a certain element of that with me as well. Like, I had a hard time finishing Breath of the Wild. Obviously, I haven't finished Tears of the Kingdom yet. It's hard to really put into words. There's a certain kind of lack of, there's a lack of the gravitas that you get in a lot of other Legend of Zelda games. Like, the power of like a single linear story can't really be understated, especially for Zelda. And with Breath of the Wild and Tears of the Kingdom style of it being fully open world, and you can really do anything in any order that you want, it just kind of loses, you can lose the momentum really quick if you don't like keep a through line for yourself. So that's what I've been trying to do. It's just being like, okay, just do a bunch of exploring and shit. I will also say, for you as a completionist type, if you have a hard time doing Breath of the Wild, don't even try with Tears of the Kingdom. There is effectively an entire extra copy of the map beneath the main map. It's wild.
Yeah, it's like the Underdark or something.
Exactly.
I've seen it,
It's like, there's not near as much content. It's mainly just running around and like exploring it a bit, but still, there's so much going on in the game. I think with Breath of the Wild, I maybe completed 50% of the content in there at best.
Yeah,
it's like all the different like really strong enemies and everything that I just couldn't figure out. It just wasn't for me.
And that's the thing too. It wasn't necessarily like the size of the game or like all the content. It just felt empty.
That's a good word for it.
It's the same feeling I got from Yooka-Laylee. Where it's like, I really want to like this, but
so nothing's ever gonna top Twilight Princess for me personally. That one will always be my favorite.
Wind Waker for me.
But yeah, that's the extent of what I got. I've managed to talk about it for longer than I expected, but still. I am extremely excited for this one this time around, in case y'all couldn't tell from the stinger. Because, hoo boy, pirates and space and stuff. It's Treasure Island and Treasure Planet. To be clear on this one, we are going to be doing the 1950 live action Disney film Treasure Island and the 2002 Treasure Planet film, also by Disney. I know that there is also the Muppets Treasure Island, but in this case, I actually just wanted to do Treasure Planet because I love that movie. So just so you know, I know that there is a Muppet version. I know it is great. Maybe we'll do it later. I don't know. But kicking into the 1950 version, we have the director of Byron Haskin. It's written by Lawrence Edward Watkin. It is based on the book Treasure Island by Robert Louis Stevenson. Its main cast is made up of Bobby Driscoll as Jim Hawkins, Robert Newton as Long John Silver, Basil Sidney as Captain Smollett, Walter Fitzgerald as Squire Trelawney, Dennis O'Day as Dr. Livesey, Finlay Currie as Billy Bones, Ralph Truman as George Merry, Jeffrey Keane as Israel Hands, and Jeffrey Wilkinson as Ben Gunn. There are also a number of other parts, but they are of mixed amount of time on screen, so I'll try to bring them up as they come along, but otherwise. Kicking into the plot, starting off on the west coast of England in 1765, a young boy named Jim Watkins lives with his mother in a tiny country inn which they run. Jim's mother, I don't think, is ever actually shown on screen, despite how much actually happens to Jim. Captain William Bones, a sickly lodger, gives Jim a treasure map after being visited by two pirates at the inn, the second of whom gives Captain William Bones a note marked with the black spot, which is a old pirate legend supposedly meaning a mark of death against someone. He then sends Jim out to get help for him with a mysterious promise to share whatever it is that he is promising. Jim does not yet know. Jim returns soon after with Squire Trelawney and Dr. Livesey. I'm just going to Livesey, I'm pretty sure that's it. And Dr. Livesey, only to find Bones dead at the inn, having died of either shock or alcohol poisoning. Jim soon after shows Trelawney the map. Trelawney recognizes the map as belonging to the buccaneer Captain Flint and bankrolls a voyage to discover the pirate's lost treasure located upon the map. Trelawney hires Captain Smollett and his ship, the Hispaniola, bringing aboard Dr. Livesey as the ship's doctor and Jim as the cabin boy. Before departure, Trelawney is taken in by Long John Silver, a one-legged innkeeper, who agrees to gather a crew. Silver strikes up a friendship with Jim and joins the expedition as the ship's cook. Smollett is concerned about the crew, especially because the nature of their journey has become common knowledge. At sea, Silver convinces Jim to acquire some rum, which he uses to get the first mate, Mr. Arrow, drunk so that he can be washed overboard in a storm later that night. Later, Jim overhears Silver and the crew's plan to mutiny, discovering that the seafarers hired by Silver are actually Captain Flint's old crew. Jim reveals the treachery to Smollett, who asks Jim to stay friends with Silver to learn more about it. Upon reaching Treasure Island, Silver offers to tow the ship to a safer anchorage, using two of the ship's rowboats. While the ship is being towed, one of Silver's men, Merry, leads a mutiny on the ship against his orders. Smollett, having been warned about the plot by Jim, can hold them off with a few men loyal to him and imprisons the mutineers below decks. Silver cuts the rowboats from the Hispaniola and heads to shore with the rest of the men, taking Jim as a hostage. Smollett, Trelawney, and Livesey go ashore after them, leaving two guards upon the ship. On the island, Jim escapes and meets Ben Gunn, who was marooned by Captain Flint some 5 years ago. Gunn shows Jim the boat he's built, then leads him to Flint's stockade, where he meets up with Smollett and the others. Meanwhile, Merry escapes, takes the ship, and raises the Jolly Roger flag above it. Silver returns to the Hispaniola, arms his men with muskets, and makes plans to take the stockade. Short of men, Silver attempts to parley with Smollett, but when he is rebuffed, Silver calls his men into attack. The assault on the stockade fails, but Silver wounds Smollett with a gunshot. Although seemingly protected by the stockade, Smollett surmises that, with the morning tide, Silver could move the Hispaniola into cannon range and level the entire fort. Jim, sneaking out of the stockade, takes Ben Gunn's boat and cuts the Hispaniola's anchor rope. The pirate, Israel Hands, discovers Jim and chases him up the ship's rigging. Hands injures Jim's arm with a throwing knife, but is soon after killed when he gets shot in the face by Jim's pistol. The Hispaniola soon after runs aground. Jim strikes the Jolly Roger from the top and instead hoists up the Union Jack. Slowed by his wound, which then becomes infected after running through swamp water, it takes him all night to get back to the stockade, which is now unguarded. Inside, Jim searches for the doctor to tend his wound, but the man asleep in Livesey's coat is actually Long John Silver. Jim faints on the spot from the shock of it. Silver finds the map on him as his men wake up and hides it from them. Merry wants to kill Jim, but Silver states that he instead wants to trade him for the map, which the rest of the men still believe is with Smollett. The men decide to go outside to vote and decide what they should do about Captain Long John Silver. From the stockade's lookout, while calling for Livesey, Silver sees that the ship has run aground, flying the Union Jack, and instead believes that Smollett's party had recaptured the ship themselves. The other pirates give Silver the black spot, but he refuses to even acknowledge it. Rattled, they let him bargain with Livesey, who comes to treat Jim's infected wound, in exchange for the map. Silver secretly barters with Livesey for leniency in court if he returns to England, inadvertently revealing to him that the ship is no longer under his own control. Livesey agrees only when Jim refuses to try and escape with him since Silver saved his life by calling for Livesey. The doctor leaves, and Silver returns with Jim, flaunting the map to convince his men that his bargain was successful. The pirates are overjoyed and take back the black spot, then proceed on a grueling treasure hunt. When they finally reach the spot with the treasure, supposedly meant to carry 700,000 English pounds, is meant to be buried, they discover instead an empty pit, save for one single guinea. The pirates turn on Silver, who manages to kill three of them before Smollett's men appear in an ambush to defeat the rest. Greeting Silver, Gunn reveals that he had actually dug up Flint's treasure himself and had long since stashed it in a cave. Despite keeping his end of the bargain, Captain Smollett still wants Silver to be taken back to England for a fair trial in regards to his mutiny of the ship. Hawkins, Trelawney, and two others take Silver to the Hispaniola aboard a rowboat loaded with several chests of treasure. Silver snatches Jim's pistol, however, and forces Trelawney and the others out of the boat, but makes Jim stay with him to steer him out of the cove. Jim instead beaches him on a sandbar deliberately, and Silver orders him to push it off at pistol point, though Jim bravely refuses. Silver becomes unable to carry out his threat to shoot him and drops the pistol in the water, attempting to push off on his own. Seeing Silver struggle, Jim instead decides to help him, waving a hesitant farewell as Silver rows away with the treasure and bids him farewell in return. Okay, jumping over to the animated feature, Treasure Planet, I'd like to quickly first preface this by reading something that is mentioned in the Wikipedia article that I was not expecting, is that this is apparently not the first sci-fi rendition of Treasure Island. There is an apparently 1982 Bulgarian film of the same name, Treasure Planet, and also an Italian miniseries called literally Treasure Island in Outer Space. So that's just a thing, I guess. I don't know much info about it. I just felt like that was worth bringing up because that there are apparently more than one here. Can't imagine that this film is based on either of those things, but you know, maybe I'm surprised. You know, so send us messages if somehow you know about either of those. That's just the wildest shit I've ever seen.
Thing I know is the Italian miniseries features Ernest Borgnine himself in the cast.
Oh, well, that's fun.
Seen on the podcast in Escape from New York.
That's fun. But anywho, jumping over to the 2002 film, it is directed by John Musker and Ron Clements. Its screenplay is by Ron Clements, John Musker, and Rob Edwards. Its story by Ron Clements, John Musker, Ted Elliott, and Terry Rossio, and is once again based on the book Treasure Island by Robert Louis Stevenson. Its voice cast is made up of Joseph Gordon-Levitt as Jim Hawkins, Brian Murray as John Silver, David Hyde Pierce as Dr. Delbert Doppler, just try saying that several times fast, Emma Thompson as Captain Amelia, Martin Short as Ben, Roscoe Lee Brown as Mr. Arrow, the first officer of Captain Amelia, Laurie Metcalf as Sarah Hawkins, Jim Hawkins' mother, and Dane Davis as Morph, the little kind of parrot insert character for this one, plus a few other characters such as Michael Wincott as Scroop, and Patrick McGoonan as Billy Bones for as long as he's in this film, which is not long. Getting into the plot, we start off on the planet Montrezor, upon which a young Jim Hawkins is enchanted by stories of one space pirate Captain Flint and his ability to strike suddenly and disappear without a trace out into the universe, hiding his loot on the fabled treasure planet. 12 years after this, we are shown Jim as a grown and aloof troublemaking teen after his father had abandoned him and his mother when he was just a child. He reluctantly helps his mother Sarah run the Benbow Inn and is caught by police after recklessly skysurfing a rocket-powered sailboard around an industrial area. Soon after, a spaceship crashes in right next to the inn, and a dying pilot, one Billy Bones, gives Jim a sphere and warns him to beware of a cyborg. Pirates soon immediately after then attack and burn down the inn, and Jim flees with his mother with their friend Dr. Delbert Doppler. Jim discovers that the sphere contains a holographic star map leading to the location of the supposed treasure planet, and decides to seek out the legendary fortune to turn his life around. It's worth mentioning that this is all within the first 15 minutes. This is a very breakneck pace kind of film sometimes. At least with a rising action. Heading up to a very cool designed spaceport, Doppler soon after commissions the ship the RLS Legacy, commanded by one feline captain Amelia and the stone-skinned first mate Mr. Arrow. The ship's motley crew is led by cyborg cook John Silver, whose cybernetics lead Jim to suspect that he is the person Bones had warned him about. After being sent to work in the galley, Jim is supervised by Silver and his shape-shifting pet, Morph, and they form a tenuous father-son-like relationship. When the ship encounters a supernova, Jim secures the crew's lifelines to keep them from being knocked overboard. As a black hole quickly forms after the supernova, some questions about physics there, whatever, a ruthless insectoid crewmate named Scroop cuts Mr. Arrow's lifeline, sending him to his inevitable death. As the ship rides the shockwaves to safety, Scroop frames Jim for Mr. Arrow's death by lying about his lifeline being unsecure, and Jim is comforted by Silver for his apparent guilt. Upon reaching the treasure planet, Jim discovers the crew are indeed pirates being led by Silver, and a mutiny erupts soon after. Doppler, Amelia, and Morph abandon ship, and Jim retrieves the map. Silver cannot bring himself to shoot Jim, allowing him to escape with the others. Another pirate, however, shoots the escapees down, injuring the Captain Amelia. Jim discovers that the map is actually Morph in disguise, and the real map was left behind back on the ship. The group meets Ben, the bioelectric navigator, a robot abandoned upon the planet that used to belong to Captain Flint, and is now missing his primary memory circuit, leaving his memory full of holes. After being cornered by the pirates, Jim, Morph, and Ben hijack a longboat and return to the Legacy to retrieve the map. Scroop attacks them, but Ben inadvertently disables the artificial gravity, and Jim kicks Scroop overboard into deep space as he drifts away. Upon returning, they are quickly caught by Silver and his crew, who have captured Dr. Doppler and Amelia. Silver forces Jim to use the map, directing them to a portal that opens to any location in the known universe with a map at its controls, which Flint used to conduct all of his raids across many worlds. They open the portal to the core of the treasure planet, which is actually an ancient space station built by a forgotten culture that Flint had commandeered as a way to stow his treasure. The pirates enter and begin collecting loot, while Jim finds the skeleton of old Captain Flint, holding Ben's missing circuit in his hand. Jim reinstalls the part into Ben's head, and Ben soon after remembers that Flint had rigged the entire planet to explode upon the treasure's discovery. Soon after, the planet does, in fact, begin to collapse, and Silver attempts to escape with a boatload of treasure, but abandons it in order to save Jim's life. The survivors get aboard the Legacy, which becomes damaged and unable to go fast enough to clear the explosion. Jim instead rigs a makeshift sailboard and rides ahead, setting the portal that they had just exited back to the Montresor spaceport, and Doppler successfully steers the ship through the portal into safety. Soon after, Jim finds Silver below decks and allows him to escape on one of the longboats. Silver gives Jim, Morph, and half the treasure he had managed to take into his pockets so that he can rebuild the Benbow Inn for his mom, believing Jim will quote-unquote rattle the stars. Sometime later, a party is hosted at the rebuilt and improved Benbow Inn. Dr. Doppler and Amelia are now married with quadruplets. Ben has become a waiter at the inn, and Jim, matured under Silver's mentorship, has become a cadet in the Interstellar Academy through a letter of recommendation from Captain Amelia. He then looks off to the sky and sees an image of Silver being formed in the clouds, which is a wild thing to be able to see, but, you know, it's probably metaphorical or some shit.
No, I think it was real.
Yeah, fair.
I think he died and Mufasa'd himself up there.
Wow. Yeah, not fair. You know what? I'll take that one. That's the best headcanon I've heard so far.
There you go, everybody. Go see Mufasa in theaters. all right. Well, let's do some full circle, huh?
Please get that out of my brain. I can't believe they're doing that shit.
I can. So we have a number of things to go through right now. We obviously had a lot more, because given this is a Disney film, a ton of people did additional voices across all of Disney's work. People like Roger Bumpus and Jack Angel and Bob Bergen. So we won't be talking about those folks. Instead, let's focus on the few that we have for 1950s Treasure Island. The first one we have here is Francis DeWolf, who was Black Dog in Treasure Island. We saw him as the spirit of Christmas Present in 1951's Scrooge.
Oh, I would not have guessed that one.
Yeah, well, they're around the same time, only a year separated. He was English, so I guess it tracks.
Fair enough.
Speaking of, as we go into the next one, speaking of sharing folks, Basil Sidney, who was Captain Smollett in Treasure Island, was Claudius in 1948's Hamlet, the Laurence Olivier Hamlet.
Oh, yeah, that's where I recognize him from.
The King and the Captain.
That's where I remember him.
John
the Lord. Name like Basil, yeah, with a name like Basil Sidney, I mean.
He's English. Most of these people are English.
But yeah, I'm pretty sure it's an English-made film, technically.
A lot of Disney films, live-action Disney films at the time were sourced out of England. John Laurie was Blind Pew in Treasure Island. He was also Francisco in 1948's Hamlet.
Well enough, his image in Wikipedia is of that character.
Beautiful. Patrick Troughton was Roach in Treasure Island. He was the player king in 1948's Hamlet.
All right. small small world here.
Yeah, he was also, not to bury the lead, he also was Father Brennan in the Richard Donner film, The Omen, which we covered. But I three Hamlets in a row, I had to get that out there. So.
Fair.
Now moving on to Treasure Planet from 2002, David Hyde Pierce was Dr. Doppler, and he was also Abe Sapien in the Guillermo del Toro Hellboy from 2004.
Oh, shit, that was it. I keep forgetting who David Hyde Pierce is, and I'm like, oh, yeah, shit, it's that guy.
Yeah, he was Niles on Frasier. We have, of course, Michael Wincott, well-known for his gravelly voice. He was Scroop in Treasure Planet. He was also Dr. Osmond in our beloved 2017's Ghost in the Shell. He's been in a lot of better movies, so.
I didn't know.
I won't hold it against him. Tony Jay was the narrator of the 2002 Treasure Planet, immediately recognizable voice. He was also Monsieur d'Arc in 1991's Beauty and the Beast, who ran the Asylum, I believe.
Gotcha. Kind of forgot about that.
And finally, Emma Thompson was the voice of Captain Amelia in Treasure Planet 2002. She was most recently on our show Agent O in Men in Black International, but she was also Mrs. Potts in 2017's Beauty and the Beast. And that's it for Full Circle.
All right, that's fantastic. I'm honestly surprised we hadn't had Peter Cullen at some point. Which is, I guess, which I still can't believe, like, yeah, he's very briefly in the film. Just, I think he just laughs, I think, at one point at the beginning of the film. I think that's it. He's not even, he stated that he's uncredited as well, so.
I mean, he's just a voice actor from the 70s into the 90s primarily, but, I mean, hey, if we do an episode on the first Transformers movie from 1984 against the Michael Bay one, we'll be touching Peter Cullen then, so maybe in the future.
I'll keep that one in mind. Yep. Well, before we get into our thoughts, and I know we usually let the person who didn't do the synopsis start off with it, I'm at least going to give a slight disclaimer here just to kind of address the somewhat elephant in the room of, yes, I have seen Treasure Planet before, and it is, it can't really be understated how much it kind of, it was a fundamental part of the childhood, all right? Like this and Atlantis, the Lost Empire, very formative things early on, very defined of like, that style kind of got locked in my brain pretty hard. So much to the back point that I'm currently running a D&D game that is basically just in a Treasure Planet universe, like style universe. So yeah, I will do my best to not be insanely overbiased, but I will say I have a deep pre-existing love of one of these already. So just so we're aware. So I'm at least transparent about that.
That's fair. That's fair. We will try to be as objective as possible.
Yes, and don't worry, I have plenty of criticisms that have grown over the years that I didn't intend, but or didn't expect, rather. But I'll let you go ahead and get into your initial thoughts, at least.
Sure. So, obviously, I have not seen Treasure Island, the 1950 Treasure Island, as I have not seen most of the live-action Disney films from between, say, 1948 to 1979, because they all feel exactly the same, and there's a million of them.
Hence my stinger. Like, this one just felt like a poster child for it.
Yeah, but Treasure Planet I have, of course, seen before. I believe I saw it in theaters, and, I mean, I recently watched it 2 years ago, 3 years ago, when I did that. When Disney Plus had first come out, so I guess 2020 into 2021, and I just went through all the Walt Disney animated features. So I had watched it relatively recently, and then this was, like, my third rewatch, I guess. Right off the bat, I didn't really care for it as a child because it didn't hold my attention. And when I rewatched it when it came out on Disney Plus, I was like, oh yeah, I definitely slept on this and I didn't really give it the time of day. It's pretty great. This Treasure Planet is pretty primo stuff. And then for this most,
they did well at the box office.
Yeah, well, this most recent rewatch of it, I was like, you know what? I don't actually know how much I like. I really like I like the concept and I like the art style, but I don't really like a lot of the other stuff that make up the movie. But I'm sure we'll get into much finer details, because just the main thing I want to jump onto is I didn't really care much for either of these on this watch around, but it is really hard to, it was really hard, man, to make it through Treasure Island. I mean, all of those live-action Disney films feel exactly the same to me. And I think there's really good performances in there. I think that the individual who, his name escapes me, but he played Ben Gunn in the 1950 film, I think he in particular was a standout for me. And then, I mean, obviously, of course, Long John Silver was great too. It was played by Robert Newton. But just right. generally speaking, those Disney movie, those live action Disney films from the time are so sleepy and slow. And we've talked about stagey looking movies before, like Death Takes a Holiday. Disney, for the life of them, could not make a live action movie that did not look like it was just filmed on a one room stage. Like, they all feel exactly yeah. the same, and it only benefits when they do a musical like Mary Poppins, because then they can kind of take advantage of that fact. I don't know. It's just, it really bothered me, and it was rough to get through, and it's shorter than Treasure Planet.
Yeah, which is wild. Did not expect that. God knows it felt longer, though. Yeah, that's really apparent in this one. It really does, like you said, there are a few occasions where it sort of gets away with it with the whole stage thing. Like when they're in the stockade and everything, it sort of can kind of get away with it just because it's in a general like jungled environment. It's like, all right, fine. Like it's nothing terrible. But like on the ship, especially where it's like, this is so clearly just in a lot somewhere. Or like, oh my God, there was a very brief moment where the Mr. Arrow is about to like, you know, go overboard because he's drunk, where he's stumbling up the you know, gangway. I used to like the gangway up the stairway from the lower deck to the top deck, and he gets like knocked back down by like what's supposed to be sea spray, but it's very clearly water coming out of like a hose or something just spraying right at him. It's like, really, come on, you could have just like tossed a bucket like a water on him, like that would have worked fine. Like, it's just, it's very much like, it looks like a Disneyland ride, honestly. Like, yeah, from like, that
we're
era,
we're not asking for like tens of millions of dollars in a special effect budget. We're just asking you to try. Yeah.
And so the environments as they are, and to a mixed degree, kind of just their getups in general, like costuming and just like set dressing and, you know, assorted kind of props and whatnot, just really very weak, just in general, just very much this of feeling of, listen, we got the Imagineers on our side. If we put enough of a bright color palette on display and enough colorful language, we can kind of get away with whatever we want. We have this precocious little scamp of a main character. He'll, you know, doughy eye his way through everything. Damn, if it's just like everything just kind of looks especially fake. I think the most realistic scene was when they were digging up the treasure and they're just in a sand pit on the beach. And I'm like, you know what? This looks like the only thing they filmed on location. It's wild.
Yes. Yeah.
I will, however, say that in response to that, though, is the fact that, damn, if the performances aren't pretty friggin' solid. Like, I was honestly not expecting that. It is sleepy. My God, is this movie sleepy? Like you mentioned, it can just kind of drone on again. That, like, all, like you said, all the Disney movies of this era are like this, and we've even covered a few of them before. But I'll be damned if I wasn't really compelled by almost everyone on screen, at times even Jim Hawkins, and it mainly centered, especially obviously on, you know, Long John Silver, since he's the one putting on the most effort for his character. That's for damn sure. And the fact of like using common parlance of the time period and everything. Like, he's the guy who defined the idea of, like, what pirate speech sounds like, obviously, Robert Newton. And it's honestly, it's using actually, like, old Cockney slang and everything with it, like, what those sailors would have been saying. And I'll be damned if Long John Silver doesn't feel like an insanely complex character by the end of this. Conniving and whatnot, and clearly, like, the earliest inspiration for Captain Jack Sparrow. But it just kind of brings a genuineness to it that I wasn't really expecting. And I actually really liked it. And even all the other guys, like fucking Walter Fitzgerald as Squire Trelawney, just being this like drunken, lush moron who's just like hiring clearly pirate crews and everything to do all this stuff and boasting about the fact that they've got a treasure map. It's just like, it's, and just seeing him in, like, in comparison to Dr. Livesey, whose existence in this film I'm not dead certain on at times, but he's mainly just there to propel the plot and actually have a level head of among that crew. But I don't know. There's just something about it that always just kind of compelled me. And it was, for as difficult as it was to get through it, the character performances really were how they are really what did it.
Yeah.
For me, at least on that one.
I guess if we're looking at it from that sort of standpoint, it's obviously Robert Newton as Long John Silver is a standout. That's kind of that Long John Silver is the standout character is kind of, you know, it goes without saying for both of these movies. Long John Silver is the standout character of the novel. Like, that's kind of the point. Mm-hmm. He is the driving
force. He's the standout
behind most everything.
He's the standout character of the series Black Sails, which is somehow, I did not know this for the longest time, a prequel to the story of Treasure Island, which is wild.
And Muppet Treasure Island, baby. Tim Curry.
Yeah.
But it's,
yeah, my God.
Yeah,
you can't make a boring version of this character.
You got to get someone who can commit to it. And the worst thing I can say about the cast of the 1951, not by its own merit, but in comparison, especially to the 2002 Treasure Planet, is that it is so easy for the characters to blend together, just because the vast majority of them are just Englishmen at the time. Of the time, you know, some of them are more official and some of them are pirates, but even within those respective groups, like, oftentimes I completely missed who Dr. Livesey was, or Livesey, whoever. I would get him mixed up all the time with the captain.
Yeah, like, I kept hearing them say squire, and I was like, who the fuck's the squire here? Well, there's no knights. I'm like, oh, that's Trelawney guys. Like, that confused me for a while. And plus, you know, my hot-blooded Americanness in me made my eyes go red anytime an English man was on stage. So, you know, it happens.
Yeah, it was pretty unfortunate. I had to devote a lot of my attention to Long John Silver. And, of course, I think Bobby Driscoll does a decent enough job as Jim Hawkins. I mean, this isn't the first thing he did for Disney, and it wouldn't be the last, because he did that Song of the South. And then he would do the voice of Peter Pan later.
I forgot about that.
Yeah, another thing we can cover at some point in the future, many times over.
And I will say, and this will kind of be my bridge into Treasure Planet. Did not expect the 1950 Treasure Island to be more actively violent than Treasure Planet. It really was genuinely surprised by that. Like, a lot of the action and fighting on screen is some of the cheesiest and hammiest bad fights I've ever fucking seen, even by Disney standards at times. But I will say there are a lot of moments that are just straight up violent. Like, for the fact that Jim Hawkins himself point blank shoots a man in the face who then falls off of the rigging, bounces off a mainmast, and hits the water. I'm like, holy crap. Like, that's a thing that just happens. Like, Jim Hawkins says the line, come one step closer and I'll blow your brains out. And then he does. I'm like, holy shit. this kid's like 10. It's like... I kind of had to give it credit for that, for the fact of like, yeah, this is a violent story when you get right down to it. And I'm sure that's what happens in the book. So,
yeah, among many issues with Treasure Planet, one of the things it suffers for is kind of just Disney's MO in general, ever since I think probably around Tarzan, even though Tarzan was more violent, for sure. But Disney really got into a rut where the premier way to kill someone is by falling, into a black hole, or falling into the center of a planet, or falling upwards because of anti-gravity. It's all falling. So
I'm pretty sure it happens at least 4 times in this film alone.
Yes.
I forgot about that, honestly, when I watched back through those. It's like, man, they really just love the slow establishing shot of person yelling as they fall into the void. Like, my goodness gracious. Like, we wouldn't get that again. Like, it's, you know, they even, the fact that they continue to use it as late as Up, but at least then they at least kind of mixed up the formula a little bit. But it's goddamn, they got real into that, especially for this one.
And I have to say, like, the art style is phenomenal, and the integration of the 3D set pieces is done very well too. That shot of Mr. Arrow falling into the black hole looks awful. It looks so bad.
It looks like somehow, I don't know how they managed to make a cartoon look like it had a green screen. How did they do that? They like superimposed him over and then just shrank his animation cell. It's like, what is happening?
And you don't even see anything. Again, at least with like Tarzan, you see Clayton, you see the silhouette of Clayton being strangled. Or I guess even earlier than that, with Hunchback of Notre Dame, Frollo falls into like a massive pit of fire, basically hell. Like, come on.
Like somehow lava in Paris. Like,
yeah, yes.
And then like even comparing that. And comparing that to another, like, the obvious contemporary being Atlantis Lost Empire, there is a character who does fall to their death, but then we actually see them, they survive the initial fall long enough to shoot the balloon that has the other main villain, who then gets crystallized and destroyed by propeller blades, which, that one, okay, like, yeah, y'all still had it in ya. You still could have done a violent death or two, come on. So, I don't know, that one was just kind of realizing that about Treasure Planet is in the middle of watching it, of wow, they really like doing this way of death in this one for some reason. Just kind of stupid. I would have given them so many points if at the end, when Silver's trying to flee, his ship just like fails and he just falls down out of the ship and into the void like everyone else. Just like,
it shows that it's the exact same shot of Mr. Arrow, but they animate Long John Silver.
They crudely paste over his cell over instead of Mr. Arrow.
Yes. You know what? But I would have liked that if it was just deliberately hacky, but
that'd be hilarious.
The other thing to get us more into actual Treasure Planet talk, and I'm sure you'll have more specific thoughts on this as well, but what I was saying earlier about the 1950 cast, how they all kind of blend together, the primo thing, one, about it being animated, but two, about it being set in space, so you get to have all these different styles of life forms, is that you don't really have that problem. Everyone is so easily identifiable. I can tell who everyone is. The downside with the Treasure Planet characters is that, with the exception of Long John Silver and Captain Amelia, I fucking hate everyone in this movie. Every character is so ungodly obnoxious.
It gets there sometimes, yeah. I tend to kind of like let myself go into the vibe that they have going. And I will say, I did actually kind of like the character of Dr. Doppler, just because I think he has a lot of like kind of quick witty moments that are just very funny, like, you know, Captain Amelia going to him like when she's delirious from a wound and says, you know, it's like, you have such pretty eyes. His immediate response to that, she's lost her mind. It's like, all right, that's funny. Like that's a very unexpected response to that kind of situation. But
yeah, I think it's just the way David Hyde Pierce portrays him, which is kind of just, I guess, David Hyde Pierce's existence is just that. But
I was gonna say, like, I'm pretty sure that's just David Hyde Pierce, my man.
Yeah, no, I watched Frasier. Even as a kid, I hated the Martin Short Ben robot character. I was like, this is clearly like funny animal sidekick, but a robot, and he's really obnoxious. But this time around, I was like, I don't like this. I don't know, something really rubbed me the wrong way. This David Hyde Pierce doctor character, I was like, he might be my least favorite in the movie.
Yeah, I think. I will say, though, like, for as annoying as that is, and as those characters could be, I do actually really like how they reworked the casting and, like, just the breakdown of characters compared to the original and presumably the original story. The fact that Trelawney and Livesey are combined into Doppler, just as both the financier, like the foppish financier, and also the more, like, level-headed medical doctor, well, not medical doctor, but the more level-headed intelligentsia type into one, I think, trim down a bit of fat that wasn't necessary. Like, we didn't have to have the whole thing of, you know, clears clutter. Like, it does that. And the fact that Ben is actually more present in this now actually gives his character a bit greater reason to exist beyond, like, mainly just Deus Ex Machina in the end, in, like, two occasions definitely. In the original, both the having the boat that he built and then also the fact that he hid the treasure in the end.
Just being a source of general knowledge, he actually has something to do in the movie, which is nice. I just wish he'd shut the hell up sometimes.
Yeah, that is a downside. And weirdly enough, once he gets his brain back, he actually becomes slightly more tolerable because he's just a bit more straightforward and he actually just becomes more useful. He's like, oh yeah, we need to leave. And okay, I'll go ahead and run the ship since we don't have the rest of the crew now. So he actually becomes competent, which is kind of nice. It would have been nice to continue to have that.
It's funny because in Treasure Planet, the main crux of the movie is Jim's relationship with Long John Silver. And I mean so that is a bit in the 1950 version, but they really hit it home here with the father son surrogate stuff, which is funny because we were just talking about that.
Yeah, like a little through line of the whole thing. Like just dad issues. And it's just, it really is like, and like you said, in the original, it's kind of more just kind of like a mutual respect thing that kind of builds up to between Jim and Silver, where it's just kind of like, you know, Silver clearly cares for this kid and doesn't want him to get hurt and caught up in the shit that he is as a pirate. And so it's mainly just kind of a moment of mercy between the two. And so it doesn't really go anywhere major. I think in the end, even Jim isn't necessarily sure about how he feels because he kind of gives that hesitant goodbye at the end. But they really turn it up to 11 with 2002. Like, they make a whole point of talking about the fact that Jim's father left and he became like this, you know, juvenile youth kind of thing. Like juvie youth and everything, like, and just started fucking up because of that without a father figure. And then Silver just kind of takes him under his wing, and that just becomes a whole big thing with a lot of the middle of the movie is kind of where it kind of drags, especially.
Yeah. Well, there's a whole what do you call it? Montage sequence, which it's fine. It drags a little bit, but it lends credence to like what's actually happening in the movie. But it is set to the worst
and I should also,
song.
Oh, yeah.
Worst it's, fucking song.
And I should say, I don't dislike the relationship that it has with Silver and Jim in the 2002 one. Quite the opposite. It's actually quite well done. It's actually very heartfelt. But, yeah, there is a pop rock song, just a normal pop rock song with lyrics and all, in the middle of this movie, to them having their montage moment over, like, their bonding and everything of, like, oh, like, teaching to tie knots and all these things. And it's just, it's so jarringly bad. Like, it's not a good song. Like, it needs to be said. Like, it's if it were an okay song, might be acceptable. But it's not. It's just really early 2000s pop rock kind of saccharine bullshit that's just goes on for any time longer than 0 seconds, which is too long.
There's a couple, when I say couple, I mean like two or three songs in this movie, and they all suck, which is unfortunate because I think the orchestration is good. I had the same problem recently with something we watched, and I can't remember what it was, where I was like, the orchestration's great, but it was the Mario movie last year. I was like, I really like the orchestration, but all the songs fucking blow.
It's like they could have just done an orchestral piece over the center. It would have been really cool. They did a really good job with all the other music. I still listen to it sometimes. Hell, I've used it in my D&D game, for God's sake. I'm like, okay, here's a grand sweeping moment. I need this music's perfect for it. It's absurd. And I feel bad for insulting it because I know it's an actual band or group or whatever that did it, but still, it's just not good.
Eh, fuck them. It's just like 20 years ago.
It's been 22 years. Oh God, it's been 22 years.
Well, speaking of even longer, like I don't want to cast too many stones because again, I think the orchestration of the movie is good. Compare that to the orchestration of the 1950 live action film, which is, you know, pretty stock.
The same.
Pretty sure comes from the same library.
Yeah, like there's a very particular way that Disney just decides to do their thing, where it's like maybe a unique tune at the very beginning, maybe gets brought up a couple more times throughout, but otherwise jack shit. And then it has the exact same concluding music where it's just like that da 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 kind of thing, Wick, where it has the end pasted over the screen and everything. It's just I feel like I've heard that so many times. I don't know how people watching Disney movies back in the day didn't go batty from the fact that they're all the same at a certain point, especially with the musical cues. I want to know if anyone back then ended up having a conditioned response to hearing that music of like, okay, now I get to relax and go home or whatever. It's so exactly the same every single time that it had to have caused a condition. Hell, it may have caused a condition in me.
I mean, I'm pretty sure the solution was just people stopped watching them. They're like, we are not going to the Disney movies anymore because they're bad. Okay. Oh
yeah.
Billy, do you want to go see The Bears and I? No, I don't want to see the fucking Bears and I. It's going to put me to sleep. The soundtrack's going to suck. It's going to have boring messages about whatever the hell, and then it's going to have, like, the weird, you know, the storybook closes and the ends on the screen. No, I don't want to go see the fucking Bears and I.
Yeah. That really was kind of a rough era for films, wasn't it? It's like, let's just be honest here. That wasn't the best period. It didn't really pick back up again until the 60s, huh?
Yeah.
And I'm sure I'm missing some grand, very specific thing. Like, this is, and obviously it's very post-war mentality, so it's going to be a lot of saccharine stuff. And like, that's fine. But my goodness gracious, it's wild to think about. This is the movie that the baby boomers grew up watching. Like, this is right then. This is when even the earliest baby boomers would have been like maybe 6 or 7, depending when this movie came out.
But yeah, I mean, it's well known that 60s and 70s, we got that sort of that period in films where things kicked up again and, you know, we started getting more experimental stuff and the rise of filmmakers, especially built out of New York, like a Martin Scorsese type. I mean, everyone go read the book Easy Riders, Raging Bulls. It's exactly about this. That's entirely what that book is. That does not apply to Disney, who was still making this kind of shit well into the 70s. They just did not learn they probably didn't learn until they started making Disney TV movies. And they're like, okay, our budgets are severely slashed. What are we going to do?
Right, yeah. And then, like, they actually started kind of, like, putting, you know, talent into, like, their animated films and everything once the 90s finally hit. And then, well, obviously, you know, it eventually culminated in this and Atlantis, but that was kind of their experimental period. So, you know, that's kind of why they didn't necessarily get the big box office hits that they were.
Yeah.
You know, it's wild to think about, because between this and Atlantis, the history of Disney not properly marketing their less ambitious film, like the films that they personally for some reason weren't as big into, it seems to have just kind of come back around again. Because, like, man, Disney's really just been releasing movies with no word on it lately, it feels like. Like, I feel like even with the fact that I've done a lot in my life lately to cut out as many advertisements as I can, because, you know, I want to live my life without being sold shit at all times in my life. But even then, I would have expected to see anything about Inside Out 2. Or, like, anything else they've been releasing. Obviously, there was, like, you know, that one that released whose name I've now completely forgotten. The one that like very clearly bombed and went to Disney Plus immediately or something. It was about like it was an adventure movie, but they didn't market it at all. Had Jake Gyllenhaal as the main character.
Strange I can't Worlds. Remember. What? Strange Worlds.
Strange Worlds. Thank you.
I was like that there's one so many like of the, these. I'm like, you got to give me yes, something more. You. So many of these have failed.
Yeah. It's something that actually like the fact that like watching it initially at least has a lot of really cool like solar punk concepts and everything. That's actually really cool and actually would have been great if they marketed it properly. But no, they didn't because fuck them. And like it just feels like they just are continuing to do that throughout history. And I don't really have a point to this. It's wild thinking about like, oh, these movies that have a very distinct like aesthetic and style that actually kind of resonate with me always seems to be the ones that Disney are like, no, fuck this. Like we're not going to care at all for these. Just, I mean, I say that Treasure Planet got more than Atlantis for sure. I mean, it got nominated for Animated Picture of the Year. It lost out to, what won that year?
I think it was that DreamWorks horse movie, which I don't like. I don't remember liking it anyways.
No, actually, it was Spirited Away.
Oh.
Yeah, in 2001. Which Spirited. It released in 2001.
Oh, Spirited Away, the Miyazaki. I don't know why Miyazaki. I was like, what the hell is that?
Yeah, the times when Miyazaki shows up and is like, hey, remember, it takes a fucking mastermind to make a damn good animated film. And you know what? Credit. Like, that, I get it. Like, that one, Spirited Away deserved the win. I love this movie. I will love it forever. Spirited Away is the better film. It just is.
Yeah.
Of course, he kind of showed up and did that again with The Boy and the Heron not too long ago.
Yeah. Not as good. But
not as good, but still cool.
The real shame is because it's, well, Treasure Planet and Atlantis obviously premiered around the same time, and they were both kind of legacy projects from their respective directors, because Musker and Clemens had worked on so many things prior, like The Little Mermaid and Hercules and whatever, and this is the thing that they were really gunning for, but they had to do other shit in the meantime before whoever the fuck it was. Was it, I guess maybe it was Eisner, because Katzenberg had left DreamWorks by that point. He was making Shrek.
Yeah.
But, so Eisner, you know, you do all this other shit and then you get Treasure Planet made. And the same thing happened with Atlantis, where it's Gary Truesdale, and I can't remember the other guy's name, but they're the guys that did like Beauty and the Beast and Hunchback of Notre Dame, and I'm kicking myself, I can't remember his name. But it's the same exact story, where it, you know, this is something that they want to work on, it's a similar style, they got to jump through all these hoops to get it made. I think Atlantis actually succeeded at the box office compared to Treasure Planet, and I think it cost less.
Really?
So,
I can see that, at least. It feels like the cast in Treasure Planet is surprisingly stacked. Like, stacked to a degree I was not expecting, that's for sure. Whenever I think back on it, I'm like, oh yeah, fucking, like, anything with Emma Thompson in it, I'm just like, wow, they got Emma Thompson. That's cool. Yeah. I mean, she's fantastic in this, obviously. But even, like, compare that to, you know, Atlantis, where it's a pretty niche cast. Like, no one in particular I could even, like, point out. Other than obviously, I just lost his name. The main character, the actor who does him, Michael J. Fox. That's it. Like that seems like the biggest name out of everyone. But even then, you listening to it, you wouldn't immediately be like, oh, that's Michael J. Fox. It's like, no, it's just a good character. Like the voice is just good.
And
at least to me.
And yeah, to bring it up, because I pulled up the results. Treasure Planet cost $140 million. It only made $109 million, so it was a loss.
Hmm.
It didn't even make back the regular budget. Atlantis cost less, roughly $120 million, but it made $186, almost double. So, Atlantis succeeded.
Yeah, fair enough.
Treasure Planet did not.
Yeah, fair enough. Atlantis will still be my favorite between the two, but I do adore this movie.
I realize I am
horribly rambling now. Yeah, but Atlantis is better. It feels like a tighter story at the end of the day. That doesn't help that Treasure Island as a story in general is already kind of convoluted when you get right down to it. Because, like, I feel like it's worth it at this point to maybe bring up the fact that the story of Treasure Island is convoluted as all hell. I feel it's worth bringing up the fact that when you actually break it down point for point, the story is so ricocheting everywhere at times, it feels like, because it goes kid working at inn, old pirate captain waltzes in, dies, and gives him a map. He is then immediately attacked by the people he is warned about. He goes to someone to get a ship to go after this treasure. The ship then proceeds to hire the very pirates that attacked the inn and somehow slips by everyone that these are obviously pirates who just committed a vandalism/murder, potentially, depending on how the story actually is. And then, like, the whole thing between Jim and Silver and the conniving on the boat and how long it takes for that to come to fruition. And the fact that, like, there appears to be several layers of mutiny happening in the 1950 film, especially. Like, at first, okay, he hears about the mutiny. They get warned about the mutiny. So the mutiny sort of kicks off, but it doesn't fully take. So Jin gets kidnapped. The rest of them go on land. The mutiny is sort of still happening. They get on land. They're hanging out. They go back to the ship to steal it. Meanwhile, the good guys go to the stockade to hang out. They now have the ship, so I guess the mutiny has now technically succeeded. They then attack. They go back and forth. It's that constantly. Of just constantly going back and forth. And it's so confusing. Like, the synopsis for this, the 1951 especially, was shockingly long for what should have been a very simple adventure film. But it's so convoluted. It's wild. Like, the fact that 2002 did any amount of trimming is a blessing. And it's so nice that they actually trimmed it down just a teeny tiny bit. It's still convoluted. They still have the whole thing of, oh, they managed to hire the very crew that the only people in town that specifically know about this exact situation. Like, how the fuck did that happen? I'm just like, I don't... Like, they could have established something where, like, oh, they managed to have an in with the captain, so they were able to game the system and get on the ship since they knew what was going on. But they never do that. It just seems to be a coincidence. It's like, what is happening? Why is any of this happening?
Yeah. It's funny because I thought you were going to talk about the fact that the Walt Disney Company has it's an unhealthy obsession with Treasure Island. At this point, because yeah. They made the 1950 Treasure Island, they made like a 20 episode mini series following up Treasure Island in like the 90s, they made Muppet Treasure Island through the Jim Henson Company, and they made Treasure Planet. That's four Treasure Island things in like 40 years.
Yeah, I think it's just because it is basically the quintessential pirate story. It's the one everyone knows about, basically. It's the classic thing of, you know, like, adventure without it being too scary, and, like, the holding up buried treasure, and, like, you get the classic kind of pirate type with Long John Silver. You kind of get to touch on the idea of, like, you know, pirates have this sense of, like, even pirates have the sense of honor in situation. It's kind of, like, lightly delving into the idea of pirate politics and that sort of thing. It's, like, it goes into it just deep enough for it to be mildly interesting about the concept of pirates without needing to get into the weeds of it, which is a very double-edged sword when you get right down to it. One that the first Pirates of the Caribbean was able actually to do very well while making it a bit more action-packed. The second and third did okay in varying degrees. In some cases, it did extremely well. In other cases, it was pretty boring. And then everything after that has been terrible. So pirates as a concept seem like Disney's bread and butter when you get right down to it.
Yeah, but I hadn't considered the Pirates of the Caribbean sort of impact on or sort of signifying that as well. It just seemed odd to me because, like, even like A Christmas Carol, which is arguably better known, they've really only done like two movies with it and then like a special with Mickey Mouse and Friends, and that's only three.
Oh yeah,
things.
I forgot about that one.
So
there's remember the Scrooge one? That one was always my favorite rendition. Like Scrooge McDuck, I should say.
Yeah, that's the one I was talking about, where Mickey is Bob Cratchit and Goofy is the ghost of whatever the hell. Yep. Or he's Jacob Marley.
I think he's...
Yeah.
Yeah, that's it. Which is wild to think about.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
Who was this evil, manipulative, miser character before Scrooge? It was Goofy.
Yeah. That's... Who then went to hell.
Yes.
that needs to be stated. They don't necessarily explicitly state it even in the original story, but this man went to hell and is carrying the literal weight of his sins. Like, whoa. That's Goofy.
Well, the only other thing I have to say about either of these is Treasure Planet, I don't really care for the ending either. It's like a dance party ending, and it's not like a Shrek dance party, you know, they're not dancing to fucking Bare Naked Ladies or something, but it is still a dance party, and it's like, you know, oh, they got married, they have quintuplets, oh, the robot is, like, serving drinks for people. It's like, okay, you know, calm it down. I actually do prefer the 1950s ending, where it's like, okay, well, you got resolution on what's happening with the character. That's all you really need. You don't need to know that Jim, I guess they felt the need to show you Jim, like, got his life around and he got a recommendation into this facility because he had more character development than Jim Hawkins in the 1950 version. But still, it's just, you know, I like the less complicated approach to that ending.
Yeah. Also, he got into that academy just purely because of nepotism. It needs to be said. Like, Captain Amelia was like, I know people. I was like, all right, this guy had a criminal record and was able to get into a high-end academy. Like, come on.
Yeah, his criminal record was, like, annoying people.
Yeah. I guess so. But even, like, when it comes to the military, that's enough.
Sure.
but like this is the guy who's gonna be flying ships and shit. But yeah, the ending's kind of, yeah, it's just, it's, I want to like it more than I do, but also at the same time, it's like, oh, that whole thing of like, oh, and these guys got married and had children and everything. It's like, all right, this is borderline where are they now level shit. Like, it just feels lazy. Like, it would have been kind of cool to see maybe Jim actually jumping forward a little bit, and we get to see him actually like piloting a ship of his own or something. Like, that would have been kind of fun. But as it is, this doesn't really add anything to the story in the end. Yeah, I don't know. I'm realizing more and more as time goes on and thinking about this movie, I really don't actually give a damn about the story. I think the relationship between Jim and Silver is obviously the best part of the film as far as the story goes. It's the best part of that. There's a strength there, and the people playing the characters are doing a great job with it. I think that's great. Otherwise, my adoration of this film is basically just the aesthetic. It's kind of shameless to that end of just like, oh, like science fantasy, but specifically kind of like, you know, Imperial English kind of stylings and everything, like with the style of the ships and everything. And it just tickles a very particular design aesthetic that I adore beyond words. And that has excused so much in this movie for me. And it's embarrassing how much so, in fact, of like going, when I get right down to it, I couldn't give less of a crap about the story. But every time they do a new like set piece or whatever, where like we get to see like the supernova and the black hole, like I think it looks visually really cool. The solar sails on the ship all look badass. All the moments when they get to Treasure Planet itself, and it's this literal giant planet-sized engine or mechanism. It's like, okay, I love that stuff. Like, it's like Jack and Daxter level stuff. And it's all just very specific aesthetic and theming kind of things that I just think are cool. And that's all I actually care about in this movie.
I mean, that's exactly where I'm at. I think that's the, like, one of the first things I said when, you know, after Full Circle is, I like the aesthetic of the movie. I'm not as big a spaceman as you are, but I do like the feeling that the movie's going for, and I think that the animation is really good, and it did a good job of blending early 3D elements without going hog wild like fucking Shrek or Chicken Little or whatever the fuck. Like, it's actually
I will say in some cases they really don't. Like, when they're on the spaceport, for as cool as the shot is where they zoom in on the moon and it turns into the space, like, you see it's actually a spaceport, like, top 10 animation moments in my entire life when it shows that. I'm like, okay, this is the coolest shit in the world. But whenever you see them there and you actually see them walking around, it's real rough. Like, some seagulls fly over screen that are the most, like, it looks like they're being held up on strings. I'm not even kidding. They look so bad.
It's mainly the details. Because of the blur.
Yeah, it's mostly the detailing. Like, if you pay attention to it after, like, the fifth watch through that I'm on at this point in my life, where you start to notice a few things like that are like, okay, this, they could have maybe just animated some birds. Like, that wouldn't have been a problem. But otherwise throughout it, yeah. Like, when it's a situation where it's not the entire environment they're on being CG, it works just fine. But, like, there's a lot of moments where, like, Silver's cyborg implements and everything, awesome. Incredibly well done. Like, I can't tell, like, if it is CG or it's not CG. If it's either one, I can't tell. And that just kind of points out brilliantly well made it is.
And that's sort of the level of integration that I'm talking about, because the character of Ben is both 2D and 3D at the same time. They alternate between shots, and you can only notice if you're like really paying attention to it.
It's stylized in such a way that like you can't see the transition hardly at all. I do love how they did it in most cases. This is a few of those details. Once you see it, I'm like, okay, they could have maybe done that differently.
You've ruined it for yourself. But yeah, like
I did.
Those elements of the movie I like, but also, the plot is convoluted, the dialogue can be grating, the characters bug the fucking shit out of me, and I don't like the songs. And it's like, I think the orchestration's cool, but the bad songs, like, ruin that for me. It's way easier for me to think of the bad songs than it is the good orchestrations, with the exception of the titular Treasure Planet theme, which the theme of a movie is usually the easiest to remember, because they use it in so many motifs, and they, you know, it kind of ingrains itself into your brain subconsciously, and that's kind of the point, but I get ahead of myself.
But like, then we have to compare that to the original, where it's just kind of eh.
Yeah.
I can't call it bad by any stretch, but I mean, hell, I think I just described all of Disney's live action films of that day. I can't call them bad. They're not bad. They're just there. Like,
Yeah, it's like wallpaper, moving wallpaper. And
honestly, yeah, that's a good way of putting it. It's a very good way of putting it, in fact.
I mean, ultimately, just because it's tolerable and it has a better aesthetic, it's able to separate the characters, and I just like animated stuff. I'm a real cartoon and horror guy. What can I say? I do like Treasure Planet more than the 1950 Treasure Island, but I think if you even go to my Letterboxd, it's like I gave Treasure Island like 2.5 stars and Treasure Planet 3.5. Like, it's not by a whole lot for me personally, but
yeah,
we're comparing two things here. One's better. One is more palatable.
One is objectively better. It is, and damn if it doesn't. I still don't know how the hell the original is only 1.5 hours. I don't know how. It drags so badly in some scenes. The fact that the introductory scenes last anything less than 1/2 hour is insane to me. I think it may have just been like I just kept getting bored and just had to pause and do something else. I don't know.
So it took a whole day to watch. This is a fucking day long.
Kind of like that. I do that sometimes, especially with these movies where I'm just like, I do it. I pause it. I make some notes or something if I want to for the show. But damn, if this one just did not hold my interest anywhere near as much as it needed to. It's what was meant to be the central crux of the film is like the relationship between Silver and Jim. Even that just kind of fell flat by the end. It just wasn't really there, at least for me. I think if we just focused even harder on Jim, I think that would have been better, but I don't know. Yeah. It just kind of fell flat.
Well, but again,
it's like that is the worst part about that era of films, especially with Disney, is that I don't even necessarily know what to point to. They're all so bland feeling by the end of each of them, even with the convoluted plot, that's just kind of like it's not even the kind of thing of, you know, I see certain moments and I'm like, oh, they could have done this so much better, this could have been a better film. It's like, no, they probably made the best film they could have made with the situation, but that doesn't make it good. It doesn't even make it that entertaining. It's just kind of there. There's certainly better historical films of the day, so.
Well, I mean, those are our thoughts, everybody. What do you think?
Yeah, so I've as rambly as ever.
Yes, I do believe so. Okay, question time.
Yes, I do actually have one as well, but I'll let you go first.
Take a classic book and set it in space. Go.
Damn it, that was basically mine.
It's that easy.
it's that easy. Okay, classic book set in space. Well, I was going to throw a curveball and say, what if we take a classic space book and set it on Earth? And I was going to say Dune, but that's honestly just a lot of the history of the Middle East. So that wouldn't really work. Which, like, you know, Frank Herbert did deliberately. So I don't know. Give me a minute to think about it. And if you already have an answer, tell me.
I just do like A Tale of Two Cities. You call it A Tale of Two Planets, call it a day.
Oh, okay. No, I dig it. I can see that. I'd say, would Alien count as Dracula in space? Because Dracula in space sounds fun.
I don't think so. I wouldn't really consider Alien a Dracula analog.
Fair. Okay, yeah. Then I'll say Dracula, just because, like, you know what? You can't have enough vampires. There are never enough fucking vampire movies. And there was another one I was going to say. Oh, yeah, Crime and Punishment in space. Just because, like, I don't know. I feel like a lot of Russian novels actually would work really well in a space environment, either like aboard a derelict vessel or just on a frozen waste planet or that sort of thing. Dostoevsky especially is just good at that, of just making those bleak environments. I think they would honestly translate to
but it's on Pluto.
Yeah. Like, I can't, like, doesn't that sound badass? Like, doesn't that sound like that would actually really work? Somehow. Like, I don't know. For some reason in my brain, I feel like that would actually do shockingly well as if they did a sci-fi version of Dostoevsky's stuff. And I think I'm just a fan of his work, honestly, so maybe I'm just a fanboy. I think I would say Crime and Punishment in space. I think they could actually work out pretty well.
All right, that's what we'd call it too. It's like Pride and Prejudice.
Yeah, Crime and Punishment in space. Yeah. And my question is in a not quite the same vein. If you had to remake a film, an older film, and that is set on Earth in like whatever like realistic setting, but then shift it to an animated sci-fi.
Animated,
not specific. Yeah, let's go with animated. Fuck it, let's go with a full nine and say like a one-to-one thing. Maybe the original is also animated. Doesn't have to be. Just, you know, let's say an animated remake for the sake of like we can just do more shit with it that way.
Right. Well, maybe like Cecil B. DeMille's The Ten Commandments, but it's robots against humans.
That
instead of the Hebrew people, they're like cyborgs. It's almost like a Blade Runner. Ten Commandments. Yeah.
I'm Jake. I'm not even kidding. Like, you gave me that concept, and I was gonna say something kind of to it, make kind of like a witty comment or something. But then I started thinking about it, and I was like, that actually sounds awesome. That sounds like a genuinely good concept. Like, you can like give the, like instead of the Hebrew people of it, like it's robots and everything. It's like, huh.
That's yeah, actually, that hasn't been done before. What the hell's wrong with you, Hollywood?
I'm sure something has been done with, like, what is that movie Rebel Moon about? No, they're not Rebel Moon. There's like this one movie called The Creator or something. It's about robots. Oh, okay. Came out recently.
Yeah, The Creator that might... is kind of like a, well, I saw The Creator. It's not the same thing. The structure is not the same. It's like, this is, you know, this child will bridge the gap between whatever, and he's the, you know, it's the key.
Oh, okay.
And,
it's that thing. Okay.
Yeah.
All right, fair. Like, that's like a pretty comparatively stock standard to Jesus in space. Not Jesus,
that's
Moses.
Like a monkey with a bomb, if I remember correctly. That movie was really fucking boring, but there was like one scene in The Creator that had me cackling my ass off. I was like, is that, oh my god, I gotta remember what that was.
What's that? There's a snippet of, I think it's a Hellboy comic, where I'm sure you maybe seen the meme of it before, where it's just one character goes, is that a monkey? Another character goes, he's got a gun, and then the next shot is just a monkey screaming while firing a pistol. that's what I'm reminded of here. It's that's what I'm reminded of in this moment. It's like, I think there's a monkey with a bomb, and I'm like, I'm instantly sold. Like, I'm sure this is a boring movie, but if it's for that scene alone, I'll watch it.
From my two-star Letterboxd review in February of this year, a monkey detonates a bomb at one point. That's pretty cool.
That's incredible. All right, that's fun. Yeah, okay, like, unironically, just, like, the idea of, like, the Ten Commandments, but sci-fi with, like, robots, that kicks ass.
Yeah,
that actually kicks ass. Well, shit, I think I had an answer, but that one honestly, like, stunned me so well that I kind of forgot about it. I think, you know what? Cool Hand Luke. I think Cool Hand Luke just would be, like, it's just the early kind of prison movie. It starts off with him sawing, like, the heads off of, like parking meters. Just, like, space parking meters. Like, it feels like it fit well in, like, the Star Wars universe or something. I don't know, just something like that, kind of like chain gang style early prison film kind of thing, just in space.
That is a very Futurama way to make a space thing, is just put the word space in front of everything, like space parking meter.
Yeah, I mean, like, come on, it's like, you know, it works. Sure. There's a scene where, like, they're the, like, in the movie in Cool Hand Luke, where they're all like working on the road, but there's like a woman across the way who's cleaning her car. It's meant to be like very like sexy and racy and everything. Like, it's the same, but they're like in space clearing a, I don't know, asteroid field maybe, and it's just the same scene, but she's in a spacesuit and still doing all this stuff, like same movements and everything, still pouring water over herself, but it's not going anywhere because it's in space.
It's instantly freezing.
Yeah, it's either instantly freezing or it's just like floating off because there's no gravity and everything. The whole like scene is completely one-to-one, but just with all like having to wear a spacesuit and everything in it. I think that would be hilarious. This is just a future. I'm just making a Futurama episode. I'm just doing that.
All right.
I feel like a hack. Yeah. Fuck, now I had another one that I actually thought would have been really funny, but I'm fully blanking on it now. Damn.
That's all right. I'll hop into socials. Maybe you'll remember by the time I'm done.
Sure, go for it.
So go ahead and follow us on any of your favorite podcasting platforms. Leave us as many stars as you like. Hopefully that's like 4 or 5. And rate and review us. We're on like iTunes, Stitcher, Podbay, Podomatic, iHeartRadio, YouTube. We are hosted on Spotify for Podcasters. Send us an email, theyremadeit@gmail.com, with ideas on future episodes that you might want us to cover, what we're doing good, what we're doing wrong. If you just want to say hi, that's fine too. And go ahead and follow us at any of your favorite social media platforms. Well, I take that back, because it is only 2 social media platforms, Twitter @itremade and Blue Sky, theyremadeit, bluesky.social, for updates on when new episodes are going live, potential episodes that we might cover in the future, posters, promo art, videos of things that we've been playing, reading, watching, discussing on the podcast, and full circle diagrams that I put together regarding actors and actresses that we have talked about in more than one episode of the show. And that is it for socials.
E.T. It's basically just the movie, but in reverse.
It's a boy that goes to...
Yeah, okay. I just realized that it is also just a future... I'm realizing anything I'm going to say is basically just a Futurama episode. Meanwhile, you picked something that actually could be high art. It's like, damn it.
It's already been animated in The Prince of Egypt. I just turned half of them into robots.
Yeah, but that's cool. It's like... Do you ever play the game Stray? Where you play as the cat?
Yeah. I completed it.
Kind of similar. Similar to that. Like, you're like, it's the society of robots and thing. I imagine the robots would look exactly the same as in Stray.
Okay, I could see that. They're, you know, they're really
minimalistic. Need to start writing this down. Yeah, sure. Like, their face, like, animations and stuff are very basic and everything. They're not, like, you know, they're not, like, those basically android humans and everything. They're just, like, no, they're just, like, clunky little robots. They're just, like, yeah, we want to exist and have our own religion and stuff.
That's our
statement. I need to start writing this down, because this is actually, like, $1 million idea to me.
Beautiful. We'll get to work on it right away. Don't steal our idea.
First step is I need to watch the first Ten Commandments movie.
Oh, that'll... We'll turn it into an episode with that and the Prince of Egypt so that you're not, like, suffering through it.
Yay!
Or, well, you'll still suffer through it, but we'll do it for work.
Content! Let's do it!
Yes.
I'll look forward to that at some point, maybe, if I don't forget again. I'm probably going to forget.
Oh, well.
Anyway. I think I've rambled plenty.
Same.
As always, I am your host, Stuart.
And I'm your host, Jacob.
Please don't steal my idea.
Sue!
Wait a minute, it was Jake's idea. I'm stealing it now. Oh, fuck!
Sir, pipe in a ha, and this be for Dr. Nipsey, asking his pardon for being that familiar, but Squire, he's told me so much about the two of ye, it comes natural to call ye by name, it do. And this'll be young Master Arkins, I'll be bound. Arkins, 'tis a proper seafaring name, too.
You run your house well, my man, and you keep a good table, too.
Thank ye kindly, sir.
It isn't often I see fruit in an English tavern for breakfast.
Ah. 'Tis a rule of health I learned while sailing under the immortal ark.